Okay, welcome to the fourth part where we are going to be talking about the custom collision tool that we are going to use for our portal. And again, we're going to start with a simpler example just because it's easier to see what's going on. This is literally the same rule, it's only a stripped down version. A simple P emitter which is spawning a couple of particles on the very first frame. And we have a P directional force simply for the gravity. And this is our P custom collision tool. First things first, for this to work, under region, we need to create a region. Right now, I'm going to show this with a rectangle, which will most likely be the kind of ground plane that you're going to use. And the region mode needs to be set to when intersecting region. Otherwise, this will not work. And let's look at this in action. And as you can see, our particles are colliding with our ground plane right here, and they're being scattered, and most importantly, they are standing still, because this is an issue with the normal P bounce, which will not be able to keep our particles still, even if we increase the roughness very high and decrease elasticity, they will never stay still, and often they will also fall through the region actually. And this always bothered me. So the great thing is about our P custom collider that this is very customizable. Like I can change the height of the first jump, which is too high right now. But I can also change the randomness of the jump. I can change how quickly they lose energy, which is this slider right here. So yeah, okay, let's look at how this is done. In our particle tab, you will see this very long expression right here and a short expression right here. The mass, this is an attribute. So the particles work pretty similar to other particles and different in other softwares by utilizing attributes which are saved on the particles. So these attributes range from the current position, the velocity, to the colors. And Fusion also has two attributes which aren't in use by the default tools, which is mass and user. You can also save other parameters in like spin if you don't need that. But for this example right here, we only are going to use mass. And one function this is, which is going to be critical for this, is the region hit, which will tell us if our particle is currently in contact with our region, which is our ground plane. And I didn't figure this out myself, by the way. The way you can learn more about this is actually very handy in the handbook. Here on page 1021, we have a conditions and region tab of our P custom tool. And here are all the different functions explained that are possible in the P custom and P custom force tools. So this should be like your first resource if you want to start working with this. A few of these things are currently broken or have been broken for years. For example, region distance. Yeah. Region distance is unfortunately been broken for years now. And I don't know if they're ever going to fix this. But for this example, we don't need this. So that's fine, I guess. Back to Fusion. First, we're going to use the mass attribute to take out the energy of our velocity. The way we're doing this is every time the particle hits the region, so this is what this if expression is for. If this is true, which means one, then we are going to take the current mass, which by default is one, and we are going to multiply that with our N4 slider. N4 is our number 4 input. So every single time this hits the region, our mass is multiplied by 0.168 right now. This means after a single hit, only 0.1 of the energy is left in the simulation for this particle. And every time this isn't happening, the mass will simply be the current mass. This means every time the particle will hit, the mass will be reduced. If you were to change this to a number above 1, then the particles would simply bounce higher and higher. And if this would be kept at 1, the particles would actually never stop moving. So it's important that this is below 1 if you want to have a somewhat realistic result. And this is all we're going to do here. This is really just here to reduce the mass or the energy that is left in the calculation. And we're going to multiply the velocity by this mass that we've created. So let's go back here. And the rules that we have in the velocity x, y, and z are similar. They also only get triggered when the region is hit. This means when the particle is hitting on our ground plane, this rule will begin its work. Every time the particle is not hit on this ground plane, it will simply take the default velocity, which right here, velocity x, which is vx. And first we need to find a way to have our particles collide with our ground plane, which means they need to change their direction. And what we need to do is we need to read out the direction that our current collider is facing, because our particles need to change the direction that they're flying to the direction of our mesh. And the way we can find out in what direction our mesh is pointing is by using the normals. The normals are, if you are not familiar with 3D, usually used for shading, which means every polygon has a normal, and this normal is a 3D vector telling your computer in what direction this polygon is facing. For example, right here we are rendering out again our plane. This time, currently it's set to position, but if I plug in this channel booleans, which is going to show me the normals, we can see the colors change a little bit. And if I rotate our plane, the colors will change, because right now these colors are telling me in what direction the polygons are facing. And currently it's facing a little bit in the y-axis and into the z-axis. And this is why in our color channels we see green, which stands for Y, is now at 0.9 and blue is at 0.5. And we can use that information to change the direction of our particles. So this means when our particles are hitting this collider, they are being forced into the direction that our collider is currently facing. And I'm going to decrease the random value right here. So as you can see, if I hit play, now they're just jumping up because our collider is facing upwards. If I were to change the direction that this is facing, for example, by rotating the y-axis right here, now you will see that our particles are using the new direction, which is now a little bit tilted, so they also jump in that direction. And we are using that direction and we are multiplying this by the mass. This is again only here to reduce the energy with each hit, so that after each hit is that the amount that they are jumping off our region is smaller. And the next thing we're going to do is multiply this with our N1 slider. And this N1 slider is really just the height of our first jump, essentially, because the normals are always going to be 1, essentially. Right now, our normals are always x0, y1, z0, because this is facing directly upwards. And if I'm going to increase this, now our particles will jump very high. This number one slider is essentially here to change the height of the initial jump. Let's get back into the particle tab. And next, this part right here, this is here because we also want to take into account the velocity, because right now I have the N3 slider, I set this to 0. But if I'm going to take my P emitter and I'm going to give this a little bit of velocity, you will see these particles are simply jumping up. Although they should, if this is going to be realistic, they should jump to the right because they have velocity in X. And this is what our N3 slider here does, which is adding in the original particle's velocity. We are taking the velocity in X, multiplying that again with the mass. This is important because we want our particles to stand still at some point. And we are then multiplying this with our N3 slider. So if I set this to 0.5, the particles will use half of the initial X velocity on each hit. This will be reduced by 0.5 each hit, and again reduced by our N4 slider, which is controlling our mass. So, and if I don't want them to take the velocity into account, I can simply set this to 0, and now they will fall straight down. You can think of this essentially like a roughness slider, I guess. Obviously, it's not completely roughness, but you get the idea. You can use this really good to customize the way you want your particles to actually behave on the collision object. So I set this back to 0.5 because this is a good number for this. And the last thing we're going to do is we're going to add in, again, a random value. And this is really just because that's ugly. It's realistic because our plane is completely uniform and our particles are all having the same velocity, but it doesn't look good. So this is why we are going to add in a little bit of a random value, which is a little bit of a random velocity. And we need to be very careful with this slider because this quickly gets too much. But you can see this is giving us a very nice random scattering. And this is, again, all calculated on each frame. But because they are also taking into account the particle velocity, this actually does look quite realistic. So I've just played around a little bit with the numbers to show you the different looks that you can get actually through this. And again, the most important bit, these particles can actually stand still on their location, because at some point so much energy is lost that they are essentially not moving anymore. And this is exactly what we're going to use for all the other velocities, because obviously we have three axes, so we need three velocity values. And the only thing you need to change is right here, velocity X needs to be replaced with velocity Y. And here with velocity Z. And I've used this absolute function. This will only make sure that the values that we are generating are always positive. And the reason for this absolute function is really just because our velocity is, because of the gravity, our velocity is actually in the minus direction. But in this case, we want this to jump upwards. So we don't need any negative values. You need to disable or activate this depending on the scene that you have. But in most cases, you will going to be using this as a ground plane. So this should be positive values. So we're going to use the absolute function to remap every negative value to a positive one. But otherwise, this is the exact same for X, Y, and Z. And now let's look at this in our actual portal. So without our custom collision tool, they just fall through the ground plane. And if we activate this, they will collide with it, and they will stay on it, and they will stay still on it. Again, this was the reason why I've created this, because the p-bounds wouldn't come to a rest. Now, this is all we need to do, and we're done with the collision example. And everything else I did for this was really just, I added a p-friction to simulate some air resistance, so they reduce the energy even more. And I've used the p-direction force, p-directional force to create the gravity. And then I've rendered this, and I've set the object ID to 2. This will be important later. This can be quite handy, because we are going to render the particles and the portal together. But if we want to separate effects for this, we need this object ID. You can think of this pretty much like a CryptoMat or a color AOV render out from a 3D software. Okay, now that we are done with our particles, we are going to be looking at rendering the portal. And again, as I've said before, this looks like trash. We need a lot of post-processing for this to look good, and this is what we're going to do in the next part.